Hello friends, welcome to video series on geography. In my previous video, I've explained about pressure belts and permanent winds. Permanent winds are a part of wind system, but I've explained them with pressure belts because both pressure belts and wind systems are highly related concepts and their origin is more or less dependent on the same factors. Whereas we have other kind of wind systems which are significantly different from permanent winds. So permanent winds are the first kind of winds about which we have studied in the previous video. They are also called as primary winds, prevailing winds, or planetary winds. They are called as planetary winds because they occur all over the planet and they are the primary winds. And they are called prevailing winds because they prevail from pressure belts. The examples are trade winds, westerlies, and easterlies. I have explained about all these winds in detail in my previous video. And next we have the other important kind of winds which are called as secondary or periodic winds. As the name itself suggests, they are periodic in nature. There are two kinds of winds where the period is only a day, that is, the periodic nature happens within a day. Such winds are called as land and sea breeze and valley and mountain breeze. And there are other kinds of winds where the periodic nature is exhibited all over the year. They are called as monsoon winds. In monsoon winds, we see the change in direction of winds based on seasons, whereas in the other periodic winds, that is land and sea breeze, valley and mountain breeze, we see the change in direction of winds based on day and nights. Other than these, we have local winds. Local winds are the winds which occur due to differences in temperature and pressure in a very small area. So they are a very localized winds, but they have a very great influence on the local climatic features of various parts. We'll see that in detail. So the best example for local winds are Lu, which occurs in India, that is around Thar Desert and Indo-Gangetic Plain. And we have Foen, which is a part of Mediterranean wind which blows across the Alps, giving a warm climate for Central Europe. And then Bora is a cold wind which influences the climate of Croatia and Hungary. And this wind blows only during a particular part of an year, like it blows only during winters. And there is Mistral. Mistral is also a wind which blows east, particularly strong in winter. And this is also a cold wind. So we'll see in detail their formation and other similar characteristics. First, let us see about land and sea breeze, which are examples for periodic winds. So land and sea breezes are nothing but convection cycles. So what is a convection cycle? We have seen that in a boiling pot of water, when we heat the below layers, the water rises to the top as it becomes less denser. And this less denser water is replaced by water of greater density, which is coming from the top surfaces. So this cycle repeats when there is more and more supply of heat, and this is nothing but convection. So this is what happens in land and sea breeze also. We have land which has specific heat which is quite lesser, whereas the specific heat of oceans, where it is quite higher. Specific heat simply means that the time required for a certain mass of a quantity to be heated. So the earth gets hot very quickly. As a result, the air parcel which is in contact with the earth or the land simply gets heated up very quickly, and hence it loses its density to a certain extent, and this air is uplifted because of loss in density and pressure. So this uplifted air leaves a vacuum at the surface, and this vacuum is filled by the air that is blowing from the seas. The air that is above seas, that is the air in contact with the sea surface, is comparatively cooler because of the greater specific heat of water. That is, during intense sunlight, the ocean water doesn't get heated up as quickly as the land gets heated up. As a result, the wind which is in contact with the ocean surface is also comparatively colder. As a result, this colder air is comparatively denser, and this denser air replaces the uplifted less denser air. So this movement of wind from sea to land is called as sea breeze or ocean breeze. So this is an example for sea breeze which occurs during daytime. So this warm air becomes denser when it reaches certain distance and then falls back to the ocean in the form of much denser air, and then it is cooled because of in contact with the comparatively cooler surface of oceans. So this cycle repeats, giving rise to sea breezes on every day. And during nights, we have the exact opposite process, where the land gets cooled very fast because of specific heat being much, much lesser. Whereas the oceans doesn't get cooled. That is, oceans don't get cooled as well as don't get hot very quickly. So here, because they sustain the daytime temperatures and hence they are comparatively warmer. And this warmer air is comparatively less denser. That is, the warmer air on the ocean floor is comparatively less denser. And this warmer air is replaced by the cold, denser air which is coming from the continents or land. So this specific wind is called as land breeze in contrast to the sea breeze. So in the first case we have sea breeze, in this case, in the second case we have land breeze. So this land breeze replaces the warm air on the ocean floor. The warm air is uplifted and it moves towards the continents where it gets denser and falls back to the ground. And here it acquires some coolness and again it moves towards the ocean. Then this cycle repeats and this is what we see as land and sea breezes. And next we have valley and mountain breeze, which is quite similar to what we see in land and sea breeze. Here instead of ocean, we have a valley. And instead of land, we have a mountain slope. So what happens in this case is the mountain slope gets hot very quickly during daytime because of greater exposure to sunlight, whereas valleys are comparatively cooler as they are within mountains and they receive less amount of insulation. As the mountain slopes are very hot, the wind surrounding the mountain slopes, as we can see in this figure, the wind surrounding the mountain slopes gets very hot quickly and hence it is uplifted. And this space which is left by the wind surrounding the mountain slope is replaced by the wind that is flowing from the valley. That is, the wind which is much comparatively cooler from the valley flows towards this mountain slopes. Again, this wind gets hot, that is heated up because of in contact with the valley slope, and again it is uplifted. And this uplifted air, once it gets denser after reaching certain higher levels, and it falls back to the ground, that is to the valley, in the form of comparatively cooler air. And this cycle repeats, that is, the cooler air moves upwards, it gets hot, again it goes upwards, it becomes denser, it falls, and this is again moves towards the slope. So this cycle repeats. This is about valley breeze, because here the breeze is blowing from valley towards the slopes. So this is called as valley breeze. In the other case, we have mountain breeze, where the exact opposite happens during daytime. In mountain breeze, what we see is the mountain slopes lose greater heat because of great amount of loss in terrestrial radiation because of greater surface area which is available. Due to this great loss of terrestrial radiation, they become much cooler very quickly, and hence the air in contact with these surfaces also gets cooler and it becomes denser and falls into the valley. So this happens from both the directions. So the comparatively warmer air which is within the valley is uplifted because of the intrusion of these two air masses, air parcels, and hence this warm air is uplifted, and when it gets to a certain level, again it becomes denser and falls back to the mountain slope, and it gets more cooler and falls back to the valley. So this thing repeats. So we usually what we have during nights is a very cold temperature at the valley's bottom, comparatively warmer temperatures in the higher levels. So this is similar to temperature inversion. So we have a more or less similar process in the other case as well. As a comparatively cooler air exists between valleys, there is comparatively less cooler air in the above atmosphere. This is also an example of temperature inversion. So valley breeze and mountain breeze are the best examples for temperature inversion. And we'll see in more detail about temperature inversion types in the future videos. And now let us move on to seasonal winds, which are also periodic in nature, what we call as monsoon winds. You know that monsoon winds blow from in the summer seasons, monsoon winds blow from the equator, that is, the winds that are coming from the west of Australia. So they change their direction due to Coriolis force and they blow across India and then they move towards parts of China. So these are nothing but southwest monsoons. And in winter, what we have is winds blowing from Siberian region that enter the Pacific Sea and brings up some moisture and causes rain in Japan and China. And some amount of this air gets into Bay of Bengal as well. Here it accumulates more amount of moisture. And this moisture brings rains to the Tamil Nadu coast and southern Andhra Pradesh coast. So usually the South Indian region and the east coast of the South Indian region mostly receives rainfall in November, October because of these monsoons, that is northeast monsoons. So let us see in a very brief, because we'll see more in detail when studying about Indian monsoons. But for now, let us think that there is a huge circulation of air, or air's convection cycle, as we have seen in mountain breeze and valley breeze. But the convection cycle in mountain breeze and valley breeze is only occurs only during a period of 24 hours. That is, there is one cycle of mountain breeze and there is other cycle of valley breeze. So the time period is only about 24 hours. But in monsoon winds, we have a time period of about greater than 6 months. For example, we have 3 to 4 months of what we can say as southwest monsoons, and then about 3 to 4 months of northeast monsoons. So this monsoon period usually ranges from 3 to 4 months, and they occur at a specific time of the year. So they are convection cycles on a very large scale. We'll see how. In summer, we have the sun over the Tropic of Cancer, and hence the very near region like Tibetan Plateau, having greater amount of rocks, gets heated up very quickly, and hence its temperatures are greater, and as a result the air mass over Tibetan Plateau becomes very hot and it is uplifted, and this uplifted air moves towards the Indian Ocean and it falls back after becoming denser, and somewhere near the equator or after the equator, what we see is this air falling to the ocean floor picks up a certain amount of heat or tries to fill the gap which is left by the low pressure system at the Tibetan region. So this air moves towards in this direction, bypasses Himalayas in both directions, or sometimes enters through Himalayas and replaces the dry warm air which has left the Tibetan Plateau. So air rushes in this form. So this is a complete cycle which is called as convection cell. So this is convection cell on a larger scale. So in other case, what we see during winters, usually this is the Tibetan Plateau is at much higher pressure because of greater coolness. Usually the sun, apparent path of sun, shifts towards Tropic of Capricorn. And in such a case, usually the Siberian Plateau is also at very high pressure. So there is high pressure regions in Siberia as well as in the Tibetan Plateau. Here, instead of convergence, there is divergence. So when there is low pressure, we see convergence at the bottom surfaces. When there is high pressure, we see divergence. So divergence occur both in Siberian Plateau and in Tibetan Plateau, and this divergence is associated with winds that blow as northeast monsoons, and this wind once uplifted at the equator and flows back and falls at the both Siberia and Tibetan Plateau. The formation of monsoons is much more complex than what we have seen this today in this video. Actually, it is much more complex, and it is not just about the low pressure and high pressure systems. It has more to do with jet streams and various other physical phenomena. So we'll see that in detail later. For now, just remember that monsoons are convection cells on a giant scale, and they are periodic in nature, and they are called as secondary or periodic winds. And Asiatic monsoons are characterized by seasonal reversal of wind direction. We have seen that. And in Japan and China, we have winter monsoons which are stronger than summer monsoons. This is because when summer monsoons flows all across India and move towards China, usually they have little amount of moisture, as all the moisture is lost near South India and East India. Whereas as these monsoon winds enter China, they are totally devoid of moisture, or have partial amount of moisture, and there is no significant amount of rain due to southwest monsoons. As we see, they have a different mechanism. There is again different monsoons that flow towards China. They do receive rains from these monsoons. But during summer, the winds that flow from the Pacific reach China. As a result, they carry greater amount of moisture. As a result, they bring rainfall to Japan and China. Whereas these monsoons, when they pass along the Myanmar, they have little moisture, as all the moisture is lost in the east coast of China. And hence, this air is devoid of moisture, or has very little moisture. But once it enters the Bay of Bengal, it picks up moisture and causes rainfall to the East Indian coast. That is only in the Southeast Indian coast. So this is about monsoons. Now let us see about tertiary or local winds. These are caused mainly due to differences between a temperature and pressure differences at a very small areas. So they are very localized, and they are confined to only lower levels of the troposphere. If we see monsoon winds, they are winds that cover not just the surface of the earth, they also move in the upper levels of troposphere, about few kilometers above the earth's surface. So they are the local winds are not similar to other kind of winds. They are only confined to the lower levels of troposphere. And the best examples are Lu, Foen, Chinooks, Mistral, Sirocco. Of these, there are certain winds which are called as warm winds, because they make the regions that are under the influence warmer, whereas there are other winds which bring colder air masses, and hence they are called as cold winds. For example, Pampero and then Gregal, Bora, Tramontane, Mistral are examples for cold winds. And then we have warm winds like Foyn, Chinook, Zonda, Lou, and Sirocco. So we'll see more important ones in this. So this is the map that shows different winds, local winds. First, let us see about Lou. Lou is the very hot wind which blows along the Thar Desert region and Indo-Gangetic plains, especially the region surrounding Delhi, northern Uttar Pradesh, etc. So these winds are very hot winds which raises the temperature of this region to a very significant level, nearly causing a temperature of about 45 degrees to 50 degrees Celsius. So if you see, the regions are about Tropic of Cancer, that is the regions of northern Madhya Pradesh and then Delhi, Haryana, etc. all are above Tropic of Cancer. And the regions below Tropic of Cancer are usually called as tropical regions. And all the southern Indian states, Maharashtra, Orissa, are all part of tropical region. So tropical region receives greater amount of insulation due to sun's apparent path based on seasons. But still, they have comparatively equal temperatures to the comparable to North Indian plains in summers because of the presence of the wind called Lou. So during summer, extreme summers, this is the sun's apparent path along the Tropic of Cancer. The sun doesn't reach above Tropic of Cancer. But still, in spite of not receiving the direct sunlight, the North Indian plains are very hot. So this makes the region quite comparable to the climate of South India, which is a tropical one. So even though it is in temperate region, literally in temperate region, but still it exhibits the climate of tropical region because of various local factors. And one such important factor is Lou. Lou is a warm wind which is formed due to intense heating of air parcels which are in contact with Thar Desert and Baloch Desert of Pakistan and Iran. We have a desert-like region in the southern Pakistan and in the eastern Iran and also certain parts of Afghanistan. So all these desert regions heats up quickly the air parcel. As a result, this air parcel moves towards the Indo-Gangetic plain, and due to Himalayas, this is their path. So hence this wind is very warm, and this wind raises the temperature of these regions. Hence, we see these very hot temperatures in the time period of May and June. And they also bring sunstroke to these regions, killing a lot of elderly people. So instead of we call it sunstroke, we should call it maybe a Lou stroke, because it is mostly influenced by the wind Lou rather than sun. So we know the Tropic of Cancer, so the direct sunlight that doesn't fall on the North India, but still the temperatures reach which are much equal to South India because of the presence of Lou. So in South India, we see sunstroke, which happens mainly due to direct sunlight. That is because sun is overhead. As a result, we have greater temperatures in states like Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu. So here the sunstroke is mainly due to the direct sunlight, whereas in North India, the sunstroke is due to the presence of Lou. And we have more important local winds. One very important local wind is called as Foyn. Foyn is a wind which blows from Mediterranean towards Alps. And once they reach Alps, they cause rains on the windward side. And that is which is also called as rain-bearing region. And on the other side, which is called as leeward side, they becomes very warm. And they keeps the land on the other side free of frost. And the temperatures of Central Europe is comparatively warmer than surrounding regions because of the presence of this local wind called as Foyn. And again, these are seasonal winds. They blow only on a particular period of year. So if you just look at the mechanism of Foyn, let us assume a mountain slope. So this is a mountain, and there is wind that is blowing towards the mountain. And due to the pressure offered by the wind from behind, these winds are uplifted once they hit the mountain slope. And during upliftment process, the temperature of the whole parcel of air falls, which is adiabatic in nature. That is, there is no change in there is no exchange of heat between the surroundings and the air parcel, but still the temperature of air parcel falls because of increasing in elevation. As there is increase in altitude, usually the pressure falls because of lesser denser air. Because of this fall in pressure, the temperature of air parcel also falls. And when it has significant amount of moisture, there is condensation, and condensation gives up latent heat of condensation. This latent heat of condensation supplies more heat to this parcel of air, and this parcel of air, because of latent heat of condensation, is uplifted to a greater level, and there is more condensation and there is more rainfall. So this windward side receives huge amount of rainfall because of the uplifting process. And once this air is reaches the top levels, it is completely or partially devoid of moisture. That is very little. There is very little moisture in air. As a result, when it moves along the other slope, it simply moves in the form of a warm, dry wind, because as it falls down to the slopes, it is subjected to more atmospheric pressure. As a result, its temperature increases adiabatically. So it is quite warmer. And also during the condensation process in the previous stages, that is before reaching the mountain slope, it has accumulated a lot of latent heat of condensation, and this also makes it very warm. And this wind, which is blowing down the valley of mountain surface or a plateau surface, is called as katabatic wind. This wind is comparatively very warm. Usually when it flows along a plateau region which is cold, usually this wind, the katabatic wind, is comparatively cooler. But when it flows down the slope of a mountain, it is usually very hot. So this warm wind which blows on the other side is devoid of moisture, and it doesn't cause any rain on the leeward side. That is why we see lush green vegetation on the other slope, that is windward side of the mountain, whereas on the leeward side we see a very semi-arid type of climate. This is because of the warm dry wind. So Foyin is one such warm dry wind which brings moisture from the Mediterranean, causes rainfall on the windward side of Alps, and on the leeward side they descend the mountains and they bring a very warm wind to the regions where the surface temperature reaches about 30 to 35 degrees Celsius. Just because of this wind, usually the surrounding regions are about 15 to 20 degrees Celsius. They are comparatively much cooler, whereas this very region which is affected by Foyin is at much higher temperatures. So this warm wind is very important in keeping the land very close to the Alps mountain free of frost. So Alps being very high in elevation, they cause huge amount of snowfall in the surrounding regions, and hence it is important to keep these lands free of snow and frost. So this wind melts huge amount of snow, and this helps in keeping vineyards and other farming activities are much more viable. So this wind is highly beneficial than it causes any kind of damage. So on the windward side it brings rains, on the leeward side it keeps the temperatures warmer, enabling rich farming activities. Similarly, we have Chinook. Chinook is quite similar to Foyin, and Chinook flows across the Alps Rockies. So this undergoes the same process. So when it descends the mountain, it is very warm, and this warm wind influences the surrounding regions in such a way that it keeps the ground free of frost. Hence, this land which is free of frost has rich pastures, and hence animal rearing is a chief occupation. And here the animal rearing is called as ranching, where a huge number of cattle are grown in a very huge area. That is, they are left to graze on a huge platform which is called as ranch. So this kind of activity is called as ranching, and for this pasture to remain free of frost, this wind is of prime importance. This wind keeps them free of frost. So this is also an economically beneficial wind. And then we have certain cold winds like Mistral. Till now what we have seen are warm winds. Loo, Foyin and Chinook are warm winds. Now we'll see what is Mistral. Mistral is a wind that flows along the Rhine Valley in Europe. It flows from about northern Europe towards the Rhine Valley. This wind is comparatively much cooler. It gives a very freezing climate to the Rhine Valley, which is occupied by Rhone River. So the Rhine Valley is between massive central islands of France. These are massive central islands. And then we have Alps. So this wind blows between these regions. So it keeps the temperature of this valley at very low levels because of its coolness. So it usually blows from the northern parts of Europe where the temperature is very cold. So we have seen in central parts the temperature is comparatively warm due to presence of Foyin. But Foyin is not a continuous wind. It only occurs during particular part of year. Hence during other parts even these regions are very cold. So all these winds which blow towards Rhine Valley are called as Mistral. So Mistral is a very cold wind. It is gusty, that is, it moves at very great speed. Hence, it is a more destructive wind. So it is not such a beneficial wind. And we have other kind of wind, which is Sirocco. Sirocco is a very hot wind. Unlike what we see in the formation of Foyin, this is formed due to other very different mechanism, where it gets hot in contact with the very hot desert Sahara. And this wind blows towards Mediterranean. And Mediterranean wind our air mass is comparatively cooler. So this whole air mass is comparatively cooler, whereas the air mass in the northern Africa is very warm because of the presence of Sirocco. So when these two air masses meet because of this movement of Sirocco, these two air masses meet in the boundary at the Mediterranean, and hence they cause intense amount of rainfall in the Mediterranean. So we'll see about frontolysis, frontogenesis, that is the front formation and successive rainfalls in future videos. But for now, due to mixing of air and warm and cold air, there is huge amount of precipitation. So this is what Sirocco does. But once it brings all the precipitation, it moves towards the Europe as a cold wind. So Sirocco is only warm on the northern part of Africa, but once it reaches Mediterranean, it loses all its temperature. And also there is parts of Sirocco which blows towards Arabian Sea, which Arabian Desert, which is also very hot, raising the temperature of Arabian deserts. So in this figure, we'll see various important winds. In this, we need not remember all the winds. We need to remember only few important winds, like Pampero, which is a cold wind, and then Zonda, similar to Foen. This is Zonda, which is blowing across Ains. So this is also an important local wind. It also helps in ranching and other agricultural activities. And then we have Chinook, which is similar to Zonda and Foen, which is also a warm wind. And then we have Tramontane, and then we have Bora, we have Buran, Karaburan. All these are examples for very cold local winds. So they are more destructive because they are gusty, that is, they blow at very high speeds and they cause little destruction to vegetation and life forms. And then we have Foen. We have seen Foen is a warm wind flowing from Mediterranean towards Central Europe. And then we have Grigale, which is a part of Greece, which is also a cold wind. And then there is Khamshin, which is similar to Sirocco, which increases the temperature of Eastern Mediterranean and Arabian Desert. So these are few important local winds. So there are many given in this picture, but we need not remember all these things, as for general studies purpose, only a few important ones like Sirocco, Foen, Zonda, and Chinook and Pampero. So only these are the important ones, because they greatly influence climatic factors in these regions. And when studying climatic regions, we'll encounter these winds and the influence on local climates. So just remember the importance of these few winds. And most important one is the table, which is cold wind and which is a warm wind. Foen, Chinook, Zonda, Lu, Sirocco are all warm winds, whereas cold winds are like Grigale, Bora, Mistral, etc. A small trick to remember this is any wind that descends a mountain slope is a warm wind, more or less. And there are other kinds of warm winds which blow from hotter regions like Sahara and Thar Desert. So warm winds are mainly associated with these kind of regions. Whereas again, winds that blow from cooler regions like much northern latitudes are very cold in nature. So they are cold winds. So if you just know the location, you'll be able to remember the difference between cold and warm winds. So this is all about different wind systems. And thanks for watching. Please like, share and subscribe to my channel to stay updated. And thanks for watching. You can share them with your friends so that it will reach more number of people. And thanks again for watching.